this talk now is a sort of continuation of mine yesterday. So I was introducing all this machinery of algebraic varieties of any dimension and cycles on them. And well, I don't know if I was quite quick because I had to introduce many things. And today I want to really write down an explicit example so that this my variety of my first talk V, this will have dimension 3, and it will actually be the 3 copies of the classical modular curve. So this way you won't also get confused with the numerology. So now C will be 2, D, the dimension of the variety, will be 3. Okay? And the main diagram that I explained in my first talk was this one. And this map on the left, this map phi, I said that we often don't know how to prove that this map exists, but we know that sometimes it's a consequence of Tate's conjecture. In this example, we will construct explicitly this map, so we won't be talking about Tate's conjecture because we will be giving the map, so it won't be conjectural. And then all the remaining things are just definitions that I defined in the general setting, and I will repeat them again here in this concrete example. Okay? And the main goal is being able to compute the point down here. So the nice thing about the arrows on the left is that these are varieties defined over Q. So if you put any cycle there, which is, say, a cycle defined over Q, since everything is algebraic, goes down to a point which is a rational point. And this is a proof of the statement, it's not conjectural. On the right, we are passing to the complex numbers. So we lose the arithmetic, but since we know that all arises from arithmetic, it's well behaved. But on the right, it's useful for computation. So when we do it on the right, we get a complex point, but we know that it arises from a point over Q. So this will be the computational side, and this will be the side that allows us to prove things. Okay? So now we'll be most concerned with the right side, and mainly the piece, the ingredient which is missing yet is, okay, so this is a very nice map, but now you have to give me some input. I mean, if you don't give me some cycles on this Chow 2, which are interesting, because you can always say the cycle which is 0, so this goes to 0, so you have to be able to produce some nice cycles, which when you map them down, you expect or can check numerically, which these are rational points, which are non-torsion, for instance, or whatever. Okay. So, this is my thing. And the other thing that I would like to start explaining, though, is the connection of all these with L functions. Since, in the end, we want to relate all this with the Bertin-Schwarzenegger conjecture, this geometric construction also has a relationship with L functions. Okay, so let's recall first the basic things. So let F be any new form. So I could put here any weight, but just for this lecture, it will be weight 2, a new form. So is that okay? Okay. These Fourier coefficients, when we normalize this form so that the first coefficient is 1, when you consider this field, which you obtain when adjoining all the Fourier coefficients, this turns out to be a number field of finite degree over Q. This degree is finite, called DF. Okay? And to F, we can attach like two sorts of data, a geometric data and L function data. So in geometry, say the geometry of F would be the following. So first, to F, you can attach holomorphic differential form. So this is an element here. Okay, where x is x not n. Great. And you have a diagram. is Jacobian of this modular curve. X is x naught of n all the time, which we were also calling it peak naught of x. Usually people put it here just but because this is also CHO 1. So this index is here will be codimension. So this is a curve, dimension 1. Codimension 1 means points, so degree 0 divisors. And this is acted by the so-called Hecke algebra. The Hecke algebra is the algebra generated by Hecke operators, one for each prime, say here, not dividing the level, okay, say over Q, so this is a Q algebra. And there is a natural map from this Q algebra to this field, which maps any such Hecke operator to the Hecke eigenvalue, okay? And if you are now define, this will be like a definition, AF to be the maximal quotient on which this Hecke algebra acts through this quotient, so this is the definition of A sub F, this means that, well, this field is a subfield of the algebra, coalgebra of endomorphisms of this abelian variety, okay? This is a field of degree DF, and this turns out to be an abelian variety of dimension DF. It's easy to show. So, for instance, if you want to assume all the time that F has rational Fourier coefficients, so that DF is 1, this is an elliptic curve, okay? And I will call it EF for elliptic curve. Okay, this is the geometry of F. The L function, L series of F is, well, you know it well because it has been repeated here several times. So it's, we find it this way. Okay, so let me define it with the Euler product directly. So this is, these are polynomials of degree 2 in P minus S. Okay, and well, you know the definition, so let me just factorize it. So it has two roots, let me write the reciprocal roots. Alpha P, so this is one of the linear pieces, and call the other reciprocal root beta. Okay, can you read it? Well, is it clear enough? Should I make, tell me, if it's too small from there? Bigger, huh? Okay. So, are we bigger now? Great. So, this is the periodic, so this is the series of the of F, and the theorem, or the basic fact, so-called theorem, is that this function, this L series, which converges for the real part of the complex variable S larger than 3/2, this can be completed. So let me use this word, complete it, to the completed L series, so to say, which will be the L series that we are considering, plus some gamma factors called, let me call it L infinity of S. This will be some gamma factors. Okay, and when you have this, the two things you have is that this function, and therefore also for L, admits analytic continuation to the whole complex plane, and the second fact is that it satisfies a functional equation. Okay? And the Bertin Fiorentino Dyer conjecture, what tells you is that the order of vanishing of visual functions, so the order of vanishing of lambda and of L is the same, let me put just L, at 1, this should be, so take the modal group of the Abelian variety, if you wish, the elliptic curve, but now, so tensor it with Q, so that this is a Z module, so now it's a Q module, a Q vector space, so, but it's also endowed with the action of this field. So it's not really a QF algebra, okay? So this is, should be the rank as a QF module, not a QF algebra, of course, a QF module. So it should be the rank of this QF module, okay? So this is the classical picture that probably most of you, or many of you already know. I just wanted to repeat it here because this is the main motivation for what we will be doing now. Because now take F1, F2, F3 to be three molar forms. So three new forms. Okay. Actually, this game you can play it with forms of different levels, different weights each. So this is what Henri was saying this morning, but just for the sake of concreteness, just fix this case. So define Q F1, F2, F3 to be the composition of these three fields that I introduced before. So this is the field generated by all Fourier coefficients. And define the L function of these three modular forms. Let me write it this way. So this is just a formal notation. But this will be the L function of the Galois representation obtained when you tensor the three Galois representations attached to each one. But if you want it to be completely explicit, let me give you the Euler factors, at least at primes not dividing n. And this will be a degree 8 polynomial in P minus S. Okay? And which is the one? So take, for instance, these three roots. Okay? And all possible combinations of them. So at each place, you are allowed to put an alpha or a beta. So you have 8 possibilities. So the last one would be beta, 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 so to say. The next one would be alpha, alpha, beta. So there are 8 possibilities. So this is the degree 8 polynomial. Okay, is it clear? Okay, so the theorem, and this is due to several people, this is the original construction of Garrett, extended by Piatesky, Shapiro, and Rallis, and then there are also results of Harris Kulla, Gross Kulla, and Dipendra Prasad. This is his PhD thesis. Says that can be completed to a completed L function, so adjoining some gamma factors and some Euler factors at the primes dividing the level. Such that, well, we have the same. So this admits this time meromorphic continuation to the whole of C, and it satisfies the functional equation as before, but now relating the values at S with 4 minus S, so the critical point, the center of symmetry is S equal to 2. Okay, so the center of symmetry is this C, C for center of symmetry or critical point, it's C equal to 2. Okay, this C will also be a codimension because, okay, and this epsilon is plus or minus 1, and it's a product, or it's minus a product of local signs, so only primes dividing the level contribute, and this epsilon p is r each plus or minus 1. Okay, and well, so the, so to say, BSD generalized, so this is actually the combination of block Kato and maybe some block conjectures, tell you that, well, so exactly the same as before. So the order of vanishing at the critical point, C, which in this case is 2, of this triple L function should be, so exactly as before. What did we have before? Okay, so there we had AF, okay? And what is AF? I introduced it there before. It's the F is a typical component of CHO 1 of X. That one is C there, because C is the critical point of this function. So we do the same. We consider CHO 2, because this goes here, of these three modular curves. Okay, the no homologous ones, and well, as Henri said this morning, on this CHO group there is a natural action of the tensor product of three times of the Hecke algebra in a natural way. You can write it down if you want this evening. So there is an action here. So you can take the F1, F2, F3 as a typical component. Okay. So now you tensor with Q, and you should take the rank as a Q F1, F2, F3 module, vector space.
What are the gamma
factors? Well, I mean, I don't know the precise recipe. It's written, I can give you the recipe. It's a natural one that should correspond to this motif. So since there is a general recipe to any motif, there should be some gamma factors. Yeah. Exactly, yes. Okay, so this is the thing. So we will work with this, the following hypothesis, which is sort of Hilner hypothesis. In the notes, we call them Gross-Prasad hypothesis, but well, I mean, we took these two names. Prasad because he's really the one who gave this description of these local signs, and Gross because, well, it's just to a sort of a sort of Gross-Aguirre formula. So this Hilner hypothesis in the classical setting is also called sometimes the Gross-Aguirre hypothesis. Okay. So is that we will be assuming that all these local signs are one, so that this sign is minus 1 because of this recipe. Okay? And, okay, so under this hypothesis, so this means that this order of vanishing is odd. Odd numbers are at least 1. Okay? So you should expect to be able to find non-torsion elements on this CHO group. We expect to find elements here okay, and well, so this is just for motivation because this is not what we do. This is what Wei Zhang and Yuan do, and they really prove that for a specific cycle that was not constructed by them but by Gross-Kudla and Gross-Schön. This specific cycle that will appear later, so I don't recall it now, is really the height of the cycle, is exactly the first derivative at 2 of this triple L function. So this is a way of check of a particular case of this conjecture. Okay, so see the work of Yuan, Zhang. Okay? Is that right? Yeah.
Is it, I mean, this is a
I don't think this is known. I don't think so. It's conjecture. It's conjecture that it should be. Perhaps you know. It's conjecture. This is a finite module, but perhaps it's not known that this is indeed finite dimensional. Okay. So our motivation is a different one here. Is the following. So let pi to be the following element, which we it will be a subvariety of four copies of our modular curve, not three but four. Okay, it will be a subvariety of dimension two, so it's of dimension two because this has dimension four. I'm not putting a zero here because this is not going to be non-homologous, and we are not interested in this to be non-homologous. And it's the following one. Just take the diagonal on the first two factors, that this will be my notation for the diagonal, the most natural one that you can imagine, cross the diagonal on the two other factors. Okay? So this is exactly the setting that I was using in yesterday morning. Okay? This gives rise to a diagram or a map that I was calling phi. From no homologous cycles here to the Jacobian of X. Okay, and let's repeat the definition. So if I take any element here, what is this? X cubed has dimension 3, because dimension 2 means it's a curve. So take any curve or any formal sum of curves, say a curve. Okay. Notice that from this X4. We can go down to x1 cross x2 cross x3 and to x4. We are transferring cycles on the from the left to cycles on the right. And we decided that left means three copies and right means one copy. That's what we decided in this example. So take the pullback. So this is natural projection here of this delta. So when due to pullback, codimensions are preserved. So this is still a codimension 2 in the place where it lives, so in X4. Okay? Now intersect it with pi. Pi has codimension 2. You can even move it so that in its rational equivalence class, so that this intersection is even transversal. So this you can just and so this is a bunch of points. Okay? Because when you make have an intersection product, the codimensions, you add them. So 2 plus 2 is 4, codimension 4 in a space of dimension 4 is a bunch of points. So this is a bunch of points. Well, okay, with multiplicities if you wish, and then project down via push forward. Push forward keeps dimensions, not codimension, but dimensions. So this is a bunch of points. You just project down the points, these are points. So this is a divisor. Call it, I don't know, PV. Since this was non-homologous, you can check that this is of degree zero, and this is your point. And if you want now, project it down to your elliptic curve, okay? So this is the point that we'll be constructing, okay? So, if you want now to do the same, but over, recall that here, there is the Abel-Jacobi map, this is Jacobian, so this is holomorphic differentials on the modular curve, so modular forms of K2, modulo the lattice, the homology of the curve, and this is field 2, what we were writing field 2 of H3 of X3 dual, okay, modulo some lattice. This lattice is basically the third homology group of X cubed. Okay, so let's recall what did we mean by this field two. Okay, so recall that this field two R. So it's a subspace of H3. So H3 are
differential forms of order 3 on this variety of dimension 3. So when you write them down, it's DC1, DC2, DC3, and you can put DC1 or DC1 bar, DC2 or DC2 bar, and DC3 or DC3 bar. Okay, these are these objects. And field 2 is that you require that at least 2 of these DCs are holomorphic. This is the field 2. Okay? So I already recalled it. And the map, since this is a map from here to here, okay, so we have phi here, so this is, I like to call it phi analytic, because this is the same map, but that just regard it in terms of complex analytic terms, okay? And this is map from a dual to a dual, so the best way to describe it is this way, okay? And if you have a holomorphic form here, one form here, say a modular form of a cusp form of way 2, you map it to. Okay, so now we'll be very careful in labeling the variables. So this is actually rho z4, because this is x4. We now take rho z3 on the third component, and I have to tell you now which is the 2 form that goes here. So this is just the cycle class map, so the Hodge class of the diagonal, okay? So now I'm being quick here because I'm not doing the whole definition, but if you check all the definitions, which Bjorn pointed out to me that in the notes is not correct because the numerology doesn't work, so I will correct this numerology, but if you work out the definition, you get this, okay? And now I can recall that the cycle... Yeah, okay, let's put that's a product. Okay, yeah, as you wish. As recall, so that this x12 is a curve in x1 cross x2. So it's a curve in a surface. So this is a map, so it's we have this surface, and we have a curve here. And the class map maps this to h2 with double this. Of x1 cross x2. And this is what we call the class, okay, which is essentially the dual of the homology class, this. Okay, so this is a curve, it has real dimension, we look it now on the complex numbers, it has real dimension 2, so it's an element of H sub 2 by duality H2. Okay, so therefore this is a 2 form here, so this makes sense, at least makes sense. Okay, so this is great. Okay, so I have to do these 2 things. I have to give an explicit computation of this map. So, okay, so now, therefore, this means that this point PD, which is a point on our Jacobian, okay, if you wish just to be explicit, project it to the elliptic curve. So let's assume now for simplicity that AF, so F has rational Fourier coefficients, so this is an elliptic curve. So this is a point, and how do you compute it? So this will be a number modulo a lattice. So I have to give you the number, okay? And by definition, if you chase this diagram, if you go this way, what you get is that this is something which is still quite complicated. Okay, so delta is here, we map it down here, it's an element of the dual of this, we can apply it to this thing, okay, and now this is a complex number, and the class of this is the point, okay? So this is not still quite satisfactory because, to begin with, this is for any delta. If I don't construct for you some explicit delta, this is not interesting. And second, this is, well, by definition, this rho is omega. Yes, call it rho f. Okay? And this is the integral against any. This will be a topological cycle of real dimension 3, whose boundary is this topological cycle of real dimension 2. So this makes sense again. Against this guy here, which is a three form. So integrating a three form against a three cycle makes sense. So everything is well defined. Okay, so I need to be able to construct interesting deltas and to be able to compute this integral, because I mean, integrating a three form against a three cycle, which is not explicitly given, is, I mean, it's like having nothing. No? So the goal is being able to compute this in terms of path integrals. So integrals, which will be like path integrals, that we can put it in the computer. And namely, this will be like what we call, what Chen calls iterated path integrals, or what Manin would call iterated modular symbols. Okay, so something which should be. Say it again. So yeah. So if you choose two different representatives, exactly. Yes. Just by definition, but in this lattice here, so two different elements here, whose boundary is delta, differ by an element in H3 of the cubed curve. So in this lattice. So. And this goes down to the lattice here. Exactly. Okay. So, well, I mean, I have to do many things, so I don't know if I have time. So I have to do two things, no? To construct cycles delta here, and to compute this integral. So what we do, and this is just a generalization of what Gross and Kullak did, we construct a map from the peak, so divisors, so curves, on this surface to the place where we are interested in. So you could now tell me, okay, but you gain nothing doing this, because if you weren't able to find interesting guys here, you are just transferring this to constructing interesting guys here. But if you don't know how to construct nice curves here, so this is not interesting, okay? So at least two remarks. Here I didn't put a zero. So this means that I'm not forced to construct a non-homologous cycle here. In general, constructing from a cycle, making it non-homologous is not easy in general, okay? And the other remark is that here, so this is two copies of the same modular curve. This is standard. For instance, to begin with, the diagonal is here. So this is already an element here. And the Hecke correspondences are naturally divisors on this surface. If you recall, this is what I was going to give in detail, but the Hecke correspondence is this, a correspondence from this curve to this curve, okay? And are those pairs of elliptic curves which are related by an extension of the grip. This gives you some variety of on S1 cross X2, which is of dimension 1. Okay? So you know that S12 is here and TP is here. Okay? Fantastic. So how does it map work? So this map, I will call it Psi. It will actually be a composition of two maps, Psi1 and Psi2. So the official definition of Psi1 is a correspondence on x cubed cross x squared. So a correspondence on x to the fifth power. Okay? So I'm going just to give the definition, which is the one that you use to compute, but which only works when this divisor here is not horizontal nor vertical. Okay, so take any T here, any curve, say. Assume it not to be neither horizontal nor vertical, and do the following. So this curve is something like this. This is T. And consider the following map, phi T, from Z to projection to the first factor, x1. So this is x1, and this is x2. Okay, and now, well, since x1, x2, and x3 is the same, So really see this, the target being x3. Okay? And define delta t the following cycle. So this will be a cycle here. But this will not be yet non-homologous, okay? Because this will be the first process, so to say. So take the graph of this morphism of curves. So this is a curve from z to x3. So this lands in z cross x3. Ah, sorry, yes. Thanks. Okay, so this is a graph in this product of two curves. So it's a graph, so it has dimension 1, codimension 2, it makes sense. Now take t itself cross any base point on x3, call it O3, and minus O1, O2, x3, and this has a multiplicity called d, where d is the degree of this map. Okay? So these are the formal sum of three curves inside this triple product. So this is a codimension 2 cycle. This is psi 1. And now from any element, so this is psi 1. And psi 2 will go, it has to go from here to the same thing. And the theorem or proposition, which is easy to show, to prove, is that for any t here, when we do psi 1 and psi 2, it lands in the non-homologous subspace. Okay? And what we do is the following. We take any delta, so it could be delta t, and you consider delta itself, and you have the natural projection to the first and third factor, and you project it down here. So you regard x1 cross x3 naturally embedded in the triple product with this base point O2, okay? And you just do the same, okay? So, psi of t will be considering delta t and applying to this, let me call it epsilon actually, well, psi 2. I like to call it epsilon. Epsilon of delta t. Okay? So, let's make an example. So this is one, and this is the one which Gross and Kudla introduced, is the one that arises from this construction when you take t to be the diagonal. Okay? So what do? You take t to be the diagonal on x1 cross x2. You apply this first operator, which is the graph of the projection, so this will be the diagonal in the triple product. If you agree, just spend some seconds checking this. This is simply x1, 2, cross the point, but if you allow me to do so, I want to write the point, minus this map, the projection from the diagonal to x1 has degree 1, so x3. Okay, meaning this, O1 cross O2 cross X3, okay? And now, okay, so this is delta t. And I now want to construct, to compute psi of t. This is applying this projector to this guy. So you have to do it three times, to this guy, and this guy. What happens to this guy? What did I say? You keep the same thing, you project it down, forgetting the second variable, so this is x13, and base point at the second variable, at the second factor, and here the same, this is x23. Okay? Now, x12, there will be minus here, so let's do the same, x12, minus x1, minus x2. And the third will be x3, well, minus x3, minus x3. And you do the computation, and you get what Gross and Kudla found and also shown and studied, so let's call it this way. this thing. So it's x1, 2, 3, so the diagonal. And I remember this morning Bjorn asked whether it's just the diagonal or you have to modify. So this is the way you have to modify it in order to be not homologous. Okay, great. So, so the main result, call it theorem or proposition, whatever, will be the following. So I was expecting to prove it. I won't have time to prove it. So the first thing, call it A, is that for all T, here, so all curves in x1 cross x2, this thing that we just constructed is really non homologous. Okay? So the proof of this is very easy looking at the Q-net decomposition. But what we do is really giving an explicit proof, really constructing three real. A topological cycle of real dimension 3 whose boundary is this thing, so that then we can really compute the integral. Okay, so that's what we do. And B would say the following. So the so there is a formula, which I will write down now, for computing what we wanted to compute, which is this. Against any three form on field two. Okay? And therefore, computing the choking the point on the elliptic curve. Okay? So in terms of path iterated integrals, which I will define what I mean by iterated integral just when it shows up in the formula. Okay? So, in order to do so, let's see. So, okay. So, the thing is, the first thing that one can show, let me call it B1. So, B1, B2, B3 will be like statement B formulated more precisely. Okay? Tells you that it's a kind of reciprocity formula. So the Schrödinger point was defined, so the Schrödinger point, called PT, was defined as the complex number, modulo lattice, that you obtain when applying this this functional to this three form. This was our definition. Okay, of the Schrödinger point attached to the to this cycle, so let me just call it PT. Okay? So what one can show is that this is actually you can reverse and put x12 here and t here. Okay, so when you put x12 here, this is the example, the basic example that we already have. And you put here this. So this, if I hadn't proved it, but just believe me now, it gives you, so we wanted to compute this, we now only need to compute this, where this is fixed now, and this may vary, okay? So B2. So this is the first part of the formula. So this is like the algorithm that in the evening sessions we'll be applying. Okay, so now, replace. So we have to compute this now. Replace tau at t by what would be epsilon t, so t minus p1 star t minus p2 star t, which I mean, okay, we want to compute this, and I'm saying that it is halfless, so we don't lose much doing risk displacement, okay? So we are going to really compute this. Why do we do this? It's because now this thing, so that this Hodge class of T, which by definition is an element here, okay, by the kinetic decomposition, it has several factors. So one factor is, for instance, this one. So this, what it does is killing the two remaining factors, H2, H0, and H0, H2. Okay, so we can really assume that this guy lands here. Okay, but also this whole thing must be in field 2, which is the case. So here, okay, so let me see, yeah. So here, we have also several components. So for instance, this is, for instance, this is a subspace here. Do you agree? And also this is a subspace here. Okay? So what one actually has is this. And this is a reflection of the fact that this guy is in field 2. Okay? So we have this here. So therefore, this element is a free form, as it's two form, sorry, which I can express it this way. So there will be some elements here. I'm claiming that doing this replacement, this guy in fact lies in H1 tensor H1. Okay? Exactly. And in fact, I claim that it belongs to this subspace I wrote downstairs below.
That's actually field 1.
Exactly, yes. This is the field 1 of. Okay? Great. So, this, therefore, since it's an element here, so you can write it this way. Where these omega i's and omega j's are holomorphic forms, and these etas are any form. Okay? Now I do the following trick, which is these guys, I will know how to integrate them, how to deal with them. So I leave this as it is. But this I don't like, and I want really to be the reverse thing, which of course I'm not allowed to do so because it's not the same. Okay, so just erase what you have to erase. This is what we put and shouldn't be here, and this is what should be here. So we have to. Yeah, okay. This is not right. I should put a 2 here. Do you mind if I don't spend time now correcting this? And I. Do you mind?
Okay, so it's. Just for lack of time, okay? So I just claim that it's a linear combination of things of this shape, okay? So the holomorphic form is on the left, and the non-holomorphic on the right, and this is a sum of this symmetric thing, okay? Sorry, I'm just being quick now. Okay, so I should be able to integrate, so we should be able to compute what? This thing where class of tau of t is of this form, so this. Okay, where these two are holomorphic and this can be anything. And things of this form. Yeah? You agree with me?
Okay, so I will finish writing down our formula for this and for this. Okay, this will be a very simple one. It will be just a path integral, and this will be an iterated path integral. Okay, but both can be computed in Sage or Magma, and that's what we are going to do tonight, so to say. Well, not tonight, because Henri needs to explain a version of this in which, no, in which instead of considering smooth forms, which is what I'm doing here, the classical version, we need to be more arithmetical. And since all these guys are defined over Q, we like to treat this H1 of X not as smooth forms, but as differences of the second kind. So algebraic diagram cohomology. Also because these things can really be computed as Laurent series, where the expansion about Q, so this will be really, okay. Okay, so which are the formulas? So the first one, so let me put it. So this, it will be just the integral against omega times the integral against eta. So these are differential one forms on the curve. So this, and here I have to put a path. I will call this path gamma sub rho. This is where rho plays a role, where gamma rho is the Poincaré dual of rho. Okay, so by this I mean that for any gamma in the cohomology of the curve, when I intersect them, this is the same as computing the integral of rho against gamma. Okay, okay. So this is, and this is easy, and this is what we need to do, and this is project B for in the evening session. Okay, and now gamma 2 is what Chen calls an iterated integral, and let me define it in three or four ways. Okay, so it will be the integral of the following two form. Against a two region, take a T rho. This won't be the most easy to compute expression because we want really path integrals, but this region is really this one. So here is x1, here is x2, here is the diagonal. So here, so to say, is our gamma, it's a path in the curve. Consider its projection downstairs, its projection to x2. So this region is, this triangle is T rho, okay? So if you want to compute it, this is what in Chen's notation, so this is a definition only, is, well, what Chen calls the iterated integral, and we will be using this notation. So this is just formal, this is just notation, because now I'm really seeing this as a differential on x. And this is a differential on x. This dot here means nothing. It means this, because this is not a wedge, this is not a two-form, okay? Because we're integrating against a path, okay? The definition is this. But if you want why people call these iterated integrals, this is because if gamma, say, is a path this way, so this is just a double integral. So zero of, well, pull back W omega to this interval, say on the variable S, and pull also eta here in this interval. Okay? And if you still want it to have a completely explicit, so well, you do the usual game. You first integrate from 0 to t this guy. So So see, this is a cache form. So in Sage, this will be a Lorentz series that you can really integrate. And now you multiply by this and integrate from 0 to 1. This is a complex number. So it's okay. So I finish here. I really wanted to prove these two integrands, these two question marks. It's not so difficult, but I'll leave it here. Okay. Yeah? Ah, you're completely right. You're completely right. Yes. So let's make this definition, okay? Thank you. Okay. So this is our definition of the iterated integral. And this, I know why I forgot this, because this is the so it will be this iterated integral. But you see, I mean, if you spend some time really computing these integrals and so on, you realize that actually this definition is not independent of the path chosen. So this does not even make sense. If you have your path gamma on your modular curve, and you take a one which is in the same class, in the same homology class, this value is not the same. So it really depends. So this is not a well-defined point up to the lattice. Okay. So now the question really makes sense. You have to correct it, okay, by a path integral. Now it's really a path integral against one form of which is not well, or one form such that where this is a one form such that different d of alpha is, and now look, w was on x1 and eta was on x2, but I restrict to the diagonal, so it's really omega z wedge eta z. Okay, so that's the definition. What's the problem with this? There are at least two problems. One is serious, which is theoretical, and the other is computational. The computational is that solving, so you are given this as an input, solving this equation is not so easy. And the second one is that in general, for our Hodge class of T, the elements that will arise here, these are not even exact. I mean, these are not the D of something, okay? Because what you really need that when you consider the this is not x1 and x2, this is really x, the natural cap product, you need that this guy here, when you wedge it, it should be zero. Not on x1 cross x2, only on the curve. But still, you won't always have this. So what I hope Henri will be explaining tomorrow, or the day after tomorrow, is that what we do in practice is we change x by y, but by y, where y is not x, y, o, not of n, it's the whole modular curve minus the cusp at infinity. So since this is affine, this h2 is zero, so we will always have this, and still the first homology of y is equal to the first homology of x. So, well, but now this is Henri's turn, so he will explain the details. No? Okay, so I'm done.